Hello, this is Colin Gold. In this video, I'd like to explain how old-style strings work in C++. The most important thing to remember is that strings were handled this way for many years from the original beginnings of C++ in the C programming language. And it's only been in recent years that the string data type that we've been using in this class so far has been in common use. Before that, and in C programs even to this day, strings were handled quite differently. Strings were quite simply arrays of type char, arrays of characters, if you will. The first line of this program has a string whose name is string1. The declaration shows it as being an array of 12 chars. The characters, therefore, will be numbered 0 to 11. We're initializing them here with an array of characters. Every one is enclosed in single quotes because it's of type char. If we count these up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there's a space, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, we'll see that in the string itself there are in fact 11 characters. Now, in old style C strings, the most important thing to always remember is that strings are always terminated by a byte, all of whose bits are set to zero. This is often called the null terminating byte. It's a character, let me say that again, it's a character each one of whose bits is set to zero, the zero byte. The way we show that as a defined constant is with the special escape sequence backslash zero. So the string hello world, which really contains 11 characters, requires a 12-byte array or a 12-char array to store it because we have to add one byte at the end, the backslash zero or the null terminating zero byte. Now, of course, as with all arrays, if we move down to the next line, if we don't specify the length of the array, C++ will infer it for us. So the only thing that's different in this line is I haven't specified the size of the array. In this, it's calculated automatically, and the length in this case would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 bytes. The length of the string is really 15 bytes, and we add 1 for the null terminating byte at the end. Now, of course, most people don't initialize their arrays like this. So in C++, instead of using an array of type char, we can use the double quotes. Right here, we see string 3. It's been initialized in this case to the array of chars. This is string 3. And the double quotes merely cause C++ to generate an array of characters. And the null terminating byte is inserted automatically. So this declaration, this is string 3 with the double quote at the beginning and the double quote at the end, is identical to the declaration up here. This is string, well, this one is string 2, but otherwise it's the same. In this case, we explicitly have the null terminating byte. In this case, when we put the string between double quotes, the null terminating byte is automatically inserted by C++ or the C compiler if you're using C. Okay. Now, in order to assign one string to another, or to print a string, or to compare two strings for equality, if we're using old style C strings, we have to do the work explicitly. And I've prepared some functions here to do that. The first function is called printString. It prints a string of any size. So you might notice here that in the formal parameter, I've specified that S is an array of char, but we don't specify the size of the array. As always, our program will infer the size of the array by looking for that null terminating zero byte. CopyString is a function which copies a source string to a destination string. If you like, it's an assignment of the source string to the destination, but we'll do it by copying the string from one place to another. Again, it should work with strings of arbitrary size, so we don't specify the size of the arrays in the formal parameter. And similarly, compare string will compare two strings and return true or false, depending on whether the strings are identical or not. If we proceed further down in the program, then we can use the function printString to print the string printString 3 using printString, and we'll print out the contents of that string. The next section of the program here copies string 3 into string 4. Now, if we're going to copy the bytes from string 3 to string 4, we must have reserved enough space in computer memory to hold those bytes in string 4. And in this case, we must specify the size of the array. So I've declared that string 4 is an array of 100 chars, probably 100 bytes, in the computer memory. How did we know to reserve 100 bytes? Well, in C, that's a little bit difficult to do. What you have to do is determine the length of the longest possible string that might get copied into string 4 and allocate enough space for that purpose. Perhaps you see now why the string type in C++ is so much more powerful than the old way of doing things. Nevertheless, in the old way, if you want to copy a string from one place to another, the destination area of memory, you must reserve enough bytes to hold the longest possible string that might get copied in there. If for some reason, therefore, we know that the longest string that might get copied into string 4 is 100 bytes, we'll declare string 4 to be an array of 100 bytes. If it turns out we copy in less bytes than that, it won't make any difference because the actual number of bytes we had stored in that string will be terminated with a null 0 byte. So we'll actually know how many bytes are in reality stored in that 100 byte array. Remember, of course, that in the 100 byte array, you also have to leave always one byte for the null terminating byte. You always need to do that. So we copy string 3 into string 4, and we output, this is string 4, it's a copy of string 3, and just to prove it worked okay, we'll output string 4. And then finally, we'll compare string 3 with string 4, and we'll output, if result is true, we'll output the string, the strings are the same. Notice, by the way, the use of the question mark colon operator here. If result has a value of true, the value of the expression is the string, the strings are the same. If result is false, we'll output the strings are different. Now, next we'll compare the string 12345 with the string 123456. Of course, we would expect those strings to be different, so we'll expect to see the result output, but these strings are different. Okay, let's run the program and see if it works as expected. So we'll compile and run. There's string 2, there's string 3. We've printed string 3 with using printString method, and it correctly says it's string 3. String 4, of course, is a copy of string 3, so that also says this is string 3 because we copied string 3 into string 4. Of course, string 3 is equal to string 4, so the compare operator tells us that the strings are the same. And of course, the string 12345 was not the same as the string 123456. So we see that in that case, the strings are marked as being different. Okay, so far so good. Let's take a quick look at how the printStream function works. It's right here. We notice again that it takes an array of characters as input, the characters to be printed. It should work with an array of any size, so we don't specify the size of the array. We leave that blank. And we run through a loop outputting each character in turn right here, where we output SI, that's the ith character of the array. We run through a loop until the SIth character is equal to the null terminating byte. So if you look at that code in detail, you'll see that what it does is it prints out every value of the array of characters that we've called S, and it stops at the first zero byte. That loop stops at the first zero byte. The next function we used was copyString, Copy string copies a string from the source parameter into the destination parameter. In this case, we've declared the source parameter as being const because we know that the process of copying into the destination should not change the source in any way, so it remains constant. And the code is very similar to print string. We'll copy each byte one byte at a time from the ith source element into the ith destination element. This is a loop. It'll copy one byte at a time from source into destination. And it stops when we see the null, the zero terminating byte of the source. Now in this case, by the way, unlike print, in the print case, we didn't want to print out the null terminating byte. But in the case of copying an array of characters from source to destination, we must copy the null terminating byte from the source to the destination, since we also need to put the terminating byte on the destination string as well. I think you'll see that that code accomplishes that objective. The third function here is compare string. Compare string takes two arrays of type char, and it attempts to determine if the arrays are identical, or if the strings contained in them are identical or different. Of course, it returns true if they're the same. It returns false if they're different in some way. Again, the code is relatively straightforward. We're going to compare the ith element of s of one of the arrays with the ith element of the other array. We're going to do that inside a loop. So we're going to compare the zeroth element of the first array with the zeroth element of the second, first element of the first array with the first element of the second, and so on. And if we ever find that an element in one array is different from an element in another array, we immediately return false, because then we know that the two strings are different. That's what this if statement here is all about. If the two elements in each array are not the same, then the strings themselves are different. Now we must stop this loop whenever we get to the end of one or the other arrays. We don't know which string is shorter than the other, or of course they may be the same length. So we stop the loop as soon as we reach the null terminating byte of either string, either the S1 string or the S2 string. If you study that code carefully again, I think you'll see that it accomplishes that purpose. Thank you very much.